Okay, first of all, do you have questions? Any question that from what I said yesterday? Okay, everything's clear. So yesterday we just stopped before when I was talking about the Flory theory for polymer, which was formulated in order to include the extruded volume effects in polymer. So I write it again here, just briefly summarize. So we have the free energy, which is written as two contributions: one from the energy, which is the comes from the two-body interaction, minus the entropy. Okay. And we said that the energy contribution is given by the two-body interaction, okay, while the entropy was up to some constant, was given by the was given by the Gaussian, the logarithm of the N-20 distribution Gaussian, N-20 distribution function for a Gaussian polymer. If you put these two things together, you minimize, and you say that R has to go like N to the nu, we found that nu is equal to 3D plus 2, and which means that D equal 1 is nu equal 1, D equal 2 nu equal 3 over 4, D equal 3 nu equal 3 over 5, and D equal 4 nu equal 1 alpha. And for D larger than 4, it's expected to be nu equal 1 half. So one can say that for D larger or equal to 4, nu has to be 1 half. Okay? So we discussed this a little bit, and we noticed that the predictions here is remarkably, in spite of the simplicity, is remarkably accurate because it's exact in D equal 1, where the exponent is somehow trivial, let's say. I told you, and you have a bit to trust me on this, this is exact in D equal 2, and is exact for D larger or equal to 4. While for D equal 3, it's not exact, but it's a good approximation because the exact value is about 0.59 instead of 0.6, which is this number here. So one now. Okay, first two things. We notice that the critical dimension here is d equal 4, namely for d larger or equal to 4, the conformation of the polymer is Gaussian again, namely the extruded volume effect do not count too much, do not count, I mean they are not relevant, and in order to see that in a very simple way, one can just look back to this expression, to the two-body interactions, right? And in order to see why these are irrelevant, one has to do in the following way. One has to insert here, in this formula, the expression for the unperturbed radius, okay? So namely, I insert this here, and that goes like KBT V0 n square divided by n to the d over 2, okay, B to the d, which is V0 B over d, n 2 minus d over 2, or V0 BD, n, if I took, is minus d minus 4 divided by 2. So what you notice is the following, that if d is smaller than 4, or smaller than 4, this contribution goes to infinity for n, goes to infinity for n going to infinity, right? So that means that two-body contributions are important and are relevant. So they cannot be neglected, which is the kind of information contained here. While for d larger than 4, this thing goes to 0, which means that two-body interaction can be neglected. Okay? So very simple. And for d equal 4, you can imagine there are logarithmic correction as at any crossover, let's say. And so one can say, okay, but here, in this expression, I mean, so one can say, okay, two-body interactions are not important in d equal 4, but what if I consider 3, 4, 5 body interactions? So because this I have been neglected here, I just counted two-body interaction. So those kind of contribution count for d larger than 4. And one can actually can do the same exercise. So approximately three-body interaction. So if I write it like 3, for instance, here, KBT. So that will be like V3, there will be some coefficient, right? Question? V3, and then there could be, I mean, the contribution to like the three-body interaction can be calculated exactly the same manner. So it will be like n rd to the power 3, so it's like rho cube, the density to the cube, times rd. So it can be calculated exactly the same way. And this is V3 n cube divided by r2d. So now to, yeah. So sorry? Ah, just to distinguish by this, I say it's like three-body interaction. If you want, this is E2. It's just a notation, just to distinguish. Okay? Yes. What do you mean? Yeah, more or less, yeah. It's this is basically these coefficients are the virial they fall from the virial expansion. Okay, so this is the second virial coefficient, which okay, you should rewrite like V2 if you want. That's the third virial coefficient, so on and so forth. Proportional to. So if I insert here now again R. Let's say the ideal behavior, what I get is like something like that. V3 N3 R to the D, sorry, N to the D, right? And then this is equal to V3 n to the minus d minus 3. So as you can see, actually these contributions are even less relevant because they become relevant only below d equal, sorry, they become relevant only for d smaller than 3, okay? But they are still, so for d equal 4, actually they do not contribute at all. They contribute even less than those, and so on and so forth. So adding new terms to the virial expansion does not add anything. So if you want, you have, you are, sorry? Yeah, exactly, you can neglect it. It's just for a polymer in a good solvent, you can take only the two-body interaction. That's it. Okay. If you want, it's the only fixed point. You know, if you do some kind of renormalization group, it's the only fixed point. For d less than 4, for d larger than 4, it's the you have the Gaussian fixed point, so everything is ideal. Of course, I mean for this particular condition, what I mean is that you have this kind of behavior for a self-avoiding polymer I mean, we were only two-body interaction count. So now you can also play a little bit. So now that we have verified that three-body terms do not count too much, actually you can play a bit so with this term here. So in general, you can a bit generalize the Flory theorem. So because it becomes very accurate and can be even for other conditions. So it does not it's not only accurate for the particular case of, let's say, of the self-avoiding polymer. So for a polymer in good solvent condition, but becomes accurate also when you have okay, this will be probably more clear later, but it becomes also accurate when you have when practically there is a partial screening of two-body interaction. What I mean is the following: when you have a polymer in a, so I mean this kind of model, I mean this kind of let's say theoretical framework that I told you now, it holds only for a single polymer chain in a solvent. But the situation can be more complicated. For instance, in the case of, let's say, chromosomes, which is, let's say, the next topic of these lectures, you don't have only one single chain. You have more chains, I mean, more chromosomes. It's a many chains system, which means that the situation that describes the physics of chromosomes is not the one of a single polymer chain, but it's one of multiple polymer chains that are all together in some let's say, restricted space, and they interact together. So it's more like the situation of a so-called polymer solution. Okay? So by polymer solution, I mean the following. Suppose that you start from, so you have a container, which of some volume, and you start adding polymers. And you start from very dilute condition. By very dilute condition, I mean the following, that you have your polymer chains here, polymer chains here, and these polymer chains, so the typical size of your polymer chains is, that we know, this is B to the N nu, right? And what it happened that, suppose that you take an enormous volume in such a way that let's say that the chain are, I mean, the typical size, the typical size of this chain is much smaller than the volume, which is, let's say, the typical volume available for one single chain, then each chain belongs, I mean, behaves like isolated, no? So the physics that describe this single chain is like the one for a single polymer chain. But suppose that you start to compact the system. So you make it smaller, I mean, the volume, I mean, make it, you start to make it smaller, smaller, smaller. Then what it happened that these polymers becomes, I mean, they start to becomes, to overlap, actually. Okay? Like this, and sorry. No. I should do a smaller volume. So I suppose that you take a smaller volume. You start to compress the system. Okay. Let's take it smaller. Then what it happens? I mean, the chains are always there. Then they start to get packed, right? I mean, like this. And what it happens eventually, they do not longer behave like a single polymer chain because they start to interact with each other, right? And then what it happened that because of the kind of interaction between each other, and because in the end the polymers are soft objects, they start to interpenetrate, okay? And so by interpenetration, eventually, it means that if So I move from here. So this is called a dilute solution. Dilute solution. Okay. Then when they start to interpenetrate, it's called the semi. Well, yeah, it depends on the language, but in general, it's called the semi-dilute solution. And then eventually, I go to maximum compaction, if you want, even smaller. When each, let's say, in the volume span by each chain, there are other chains. Hmm? So everything is interpenetrating, and everything is compact. And that's called concentrated solution. It depends a bit by the language, but concentrated solution, or if you want, you can call it a melt. So in the extreme case, where all the solvent has been removed by the solution, and you have only polymers, you have a melt. So namely, the only molecules that you have inside your system are molecules coming from the polymers. Okay, so these particular conditions, these conditions and these conditions, is the one that is more. That is one that you have to use, and we will see it later, to describe to start modeling chromosomes inside the nuclei of the cell. This is the kind of condition, because you have many chains inside a restricted amount of volume, which is the nucleus. And in order to model it, you have to use the physics of semi-dilute solution. And what has to do with Flory? I mean, because Flory can tell you something about how this chain would behave. Hmm? And that's the following. So suppose that, we use a very, an extreme situation. We use the situation where we are in a melt. Hmm? Yes. Semi-dilute. Yes, we will see it a bit later. Why it's this? But just to start telling. Just to anticipate that briefly now. Why these conditions are interesting? Because they are described, you can imagine that a bit, but they are described by different, we will find different physics than the one of dilute solution. It's more complicated. You can expect that because you will have a lot of interaction because of the presence of many chains here, right? And actually, the condition where, the concentrated solution condition, it's a bit simpler to describe the semi-dilute one. In spite of the fact that you have, you can expect that you have much more interactions here. Hmm? And the reason is the following. And that was the first realization of this thing was done by Flory again. And the fact that in concentrated solution, so when you have only the polymers, or almost only polymers, you have a partial, if not complete, screening of two-body interaction within the single chain. And so what I mean is the following. It's like two-body interactions count much less than the situation when the single chain is isolated. And this looks like a bit of a surprising result. But the explanation actually is quite intuitive. And again, it's due to Flory. And the reason why it's like this is the following. So in a concentrated solution, or let's say briefly in a melt, the concentration, suppose that you take, let's say in general, the concentration of of your monomer, because everything is packed, and so you have a real compact system, the overall concentration of your monomer, C, I call it C over R, is roughly constant. Okay, C R is the position of, it's some position in your system. Huh? The concentration of your system is roughly constant, okay? But you remember, no? D di interaction, so the interaction of to say the tubo di interaction U is proportional to CR square, to the concentration square, roughly. But as I told you, this is roughly constant, so this is actually is a constant square. Okay. So this is for two-body interaction. So that means that the force between two monomers, which is just let's say, proportional to the derivative of u with respect to r, just if you want the gradient, is just zero, is negligible. Okay, so it's a bit of an intuitive argument. So that means that two-body interactions do not count in a melt because for one single reason. Because the volume occupied by one single chain is actually penetrated by the presence of the other chains. And the other chains remove the effect of the two-body interaction within one single chain. So it's like they are effectively screened. This is a genuine many-body interactions. So because of it, so that requires a bit of a proof, but I mean, you can. Somehow you have to believe me now. So the Flory term here does not go, so I call it E2 just to say that it's two-body interaction, is no longer of this kind, but is V2 over, so it has a screening, so it has a 1 over n term times n square over times Rd. Okay? And so this is effectively like equal to V2. N over Rd. So that's so why okay, this is for single chains. Okay, while this is for a melt. So as you can see, the contribution to two-body interaction in a melt is much more depressed because it has a 1 over n terms. And that comes from the fact that you have basically a lot of interactions are suppressed because of the presence of other chains inside the volume of one single chain. That actually it's not immediate to derive. It comes. Well, it comes from so basically you have to study the system as it's called as a mixture of different polymers, okay? And then so it's like so actually you start from a system like of A and B particles, where things can. So you study the entropy of mixing of this system, and but you treat the system. So in the end, you treat the system as like any part is equal to the rest, and then that gives you a second virial coefficient, which is 1 over n, the single virial coefficient of one single monomer, let's say. It is not immediate to derive. We can. Well, maybe I can show it tomorrow. So for time being, let's take it this way. I wanted just to show you. Actually, I wanted more to point out the fact that you can still use the Flory theory even for this polymer solution. That somehow they apply. They are more. It's the correct description if you want to use it for chromosome. But it's not, no, it's not obvious. It's not like something trivial. And actually, so because of it, actually, well, because of it, actually, you can see immediately one thing. So if I put so suppose that I put the unperturbed radius here. So I just do the same exercise as before. So I have that R goes like n, so it's b, n over 1 half. what I have here, so I substitute this thing here, and I get that E2 over kBT goes like V2 N B to the D again N D over 2 and that goes like V2 over B D N 1 minus D over 2 or N minus D minus 2 over 2. And that means, so it's self-consistent to some extent, that means that for D equal 3 now, this term is no longer important. So that means that, and that was a consequence of the results of Flory, that in D equal 3 now, and in a melt, polymer chains are ideal. So that means D equal 3 melt, R goes like Bn 1 over 2. And that's actually which is the correct result. So in a melt, linear chains are ideal. Okay, not completely ideal, because the sides behaves like a Gaussian chain. So you have a different exponent than compared to the situation where the single chain is isolated. And that's the consequence of the fact that we have the screening of excluded volume effects. So it's this is quite important. I would suggest that you, it's an important result in polymer field, so you should, I mean, depends what you want to do in the future, but it's an important result to take into account. This thing, so what I did, so this is a, so maybe tomorrow I can provide you, I don't know, maybe tomorrow, but let's say, for time being, just believe in me that this means that the two-body interaction are screened because of the presence of the many chains, okay? You know, this thing, right? So why it's V2 over N and not why V2 to square root of N, this is not obvious. This, I mean, requires a bit of more formalism, but okay. So then, that means that the second, I mean, the, let's say the contribution to the energy is V2 N to R over D. So then I can repeat, because I want to I want to know which is the critical dimension for this, let's say, new Flory theory, okay? So I substitute the unperturbed radius here, as the same way I did before, and then I get this formula, and which means that for D equal, so this two-body interaction count whenever D is smaller than 2, smaller than 2. For D larger than 2, in particular for D equal 3, the two-body interaction do not count for polymer in a melt, okay? Which means that the chain, a linear chain in a melt, so when you have many other chains which interact with it, is a Gaussian polymer, okay? So two-body interactions are, because two-body interactions are screened. And so the behavior of a single chain in dilute condition or in a melt is completely different. And that's something one has to take into account when, for instance, describes, I mean, when we see for the physics of chromosome. It's a relevant condition. Because we have many chains packed together, basically. So that's why, I wanted to tell it this thing now, because in a sense it's timely, because you can still use the Flory theory. So you can see the Flory theory is very powerful. Actually, it predicts, even in spite of its simplicity, it predicts a lot of things. Any question? Okay, so I want to stay a bit more on the Flory theory. So we go, so now, okay, for this, we go back to the case, because, I mean, I want to also stress about criticisms on the. I want to tell you about criticism for the theory. I mean, where are I mean, which what are is the weaknesses of the theory? So we remain on single chains because that's a good example, actually, where things do not work. I mean, which things do not work well? And that's the following. So we said that in this case, nu is equal 3 over 2, right? So first of all, why the theory, which is important to stress, why the theory seems to work so well? Because in the end, we have neglected a lot. First of all, we have for sure made a very bad ansatz about the entropy, because as you can imagine, the entropy of a self-avoiding polymer is much less than the entropy of just a Gaussian polymer. No, you have actually for a Gaussian polymer, you have much more configuration that you can achieve compared to a self-avoiding polymer. Because basically, the conformation of a self-avoiding polymer are done in this way. You take all the possible conformation of a Gaussian polymer, and you remove conformations which overlap. But as you can imagine, the conformations which are overlapping are much more than the ones which are not overlapping. So it's a se this one, it's a serious hypothesis. So why things work well? And the explanation you typically find in the textbook is the following, that for possible reasons, you have either overestimated the entropy, which is what I'm saying now, but you have also overestimated the energy term. So you have some sort of two kind of overestimation that compensate each other by some magic somehow, or by some series of fortunate events, and then you get an exponent which is almost right. But nonetheless, the things do not work perfectly because one assumption of the Flory theory is the fact that the end-to-end distribution function, PR, is basically Gaussian, right? Because this is at the basis of the theory. So it's R square and B square. Yes. It's basically a Gaussian. That was basically the foundation of the theory. Actually, this thing is wrong. I mean, it's really wrong. So what I mean by wrong, I mean that suppose that you are simulating a self-avoiding walk and you can measure the end-to-end distribution function, you will never find this formula. So you can spot that the Gaussian approximation is completely wrong. And actually, so yes, your question.
Usually, I mean, it can be wrong, but on the large scale, but very close
No,
to.
it's wrong also on a short scale, yes. And now I was and why it's wrong? I mean, what is the correct expression? The question? Yeah, just interrupting. No? Yes, for a self-avoiding polymer. So this expression is wrong. It's the one that I've used, of course, or Flory has used. Of course, it's not me that invented this thing, but it's wrong. And the correct one is, which I have to remember now by heart, so it's something, P of R, capital, I think I use, no? So let's say the correct one, P of R, is something that has to go like R to the theta times the exponential of minus k, so it is a bit R to b n to the nu, 1 over 1 minus nu. So I say, okay, that's a bit, looks a bit ugly, but that actually, that's the correct expression. So in that function is called Redner de Cloison. That provides a very good description of the end-to-end distribution function for a self-avoiding polymer. And why, to come to your question, well, this function, first of all, okay, first of all, this function is a sort of a generalization of the Gaussian function, of the Gaussian function, for the following reason. Hmm? So this nu is precisely the same exponent nu. So in particular, if you have theta equal zero and nu equal 1/2, okay, you get exactly back the expression for the Gaussian, which is okay, which is correct, why I tell you now. While, so this is for a Gaussian, okay? No, theta is another exponent. Oh, then I will tell you, wait a second. Because it tells us also why the Fourier, where is wrong the Fourier theory. While for Gaussian or ideal polymer, if you, okay, let's say ideal polymer. While for a self-avoiding polymer, we have theta larger than zero, and nu, I mean, larger than 1/2, let's say, for a self-avoiding polymer. So, well, actually, that should be written more precisely this way, b n to the nu theta. Oh, I mean, the dependence is the same, but just to be why it's important, that factor, I will tell you now. So to answer your question, why to answer your question, why this, I mean, this is the correct formula, even intuitively, because actually this term actually is depressing the fact that you can make the two ends close together, because that's impossible, actually, because we have excluded volume effects, even between the two ends, right? So then this exponent theta has to be larger than zero, okay, first. And second, so that terms here basically come from the fact that excluded volume effect, in some sense, overstretch the chain compared to the, let's say, to the case where you don't have those excluded volume effect. And so that's why this function has this some sort of funny behavior. And that was proposed for the first time by these two guys. Yes. It's not totally empirical. So actually for r equals zero, that has to be so, because that means that you have basically the probability to close the chain has to be zero. Hmm? For larger r, okay, of course this you can neglect this term because it's just for a large r. Then for large r, that comes from the fact that, as I said, so it's because you are let's say you have the excluded volume effect tend to overstretch the chain. So if you take these two contributions into account, this is actually this formula is not completely exact, but it provides a very, very good description of the data. In particular,
is there any way to go back to the
energy? You mean take this to go to use that in flow, or?
No, I mean to find the associated potential energy.
What do you mean?
Yeah, so it's a problem with polymers, and each polymer is filling an effective potential mode, which has a certain shape, and you could relate this shape to this expression. I mean, that's what we have done in the Fourier theory. So, your potential is basically harmonic.
Ah, you mean, yeah, exactly. So what you mean that I use this here? Or no? Or go back, or you mean the reverse?
No, I mean, from this formula, going back?
No, I mean, you can do that, but you get worse. You get a worse result. That's because you are, actually, the reason for that is because you are correcting only this term, but you're not correcting this. So that's remain incorrect. Of course, you can correct this, but then you have to put some kind of effective correction because you cannot predict that a priori. And then, of course, you can do that, but then it's a fit. I mean, then you don't. You need something that you need to fix, and you don't have it. But my point here, I mean, more than that, is that this formula. So this is correct. I mean, if you have, for instance, a simulation of a self-winding walk, you can use this formula to, for instance, to fit to the data and find theta. Okay, nu you have, and you can find theta. Okay, you don't have nu, but you can find also nu from the data, from your simulation, of course. But then what I mean is that you can find either nu and theta. And actually, theta is quite different from zero. So there was one question. Sorry.
I just wanted to ask, what is k?
K is a constant, and actually, to find it, you fix it by imposing that this function as norm 1, so it's a constant. So if you integrate this and you impose that this is norm 1, this k is given in some terms of some gamma function, but it's a constant. Yes. Well, the dimension enter in nu and theta because those depends on the dimension. But the shape is the same. Let's say no. The shape also will change. Depends on the dimension because it depends on theta and nu. But the dimension is hidden here. Okay. And yes. Well, that's the kind of explanation that is given in textbook. To be honest, it's not never been completely clear to me, but it has to be something like that because for sure, this has been overestimated, right? Because we have much less conformation for a self-avoiding chain with respect to a Gaussian chain. And so then this has to be, was underestimated as well, in order to compensate for the right, for the reason why we get a very good exponent. But in the end, that's the only exponent we get, because we have no way, by using the Fourier theory, to get the theta exponent, which actually is quite important as well, because that gives you the, let's say, that is correlated to the formation of contacts between the ends of a self-avoiding polymer, this data. And just to conclude this, actually theta is related to the entropy of the self-avoiding walk. In which way? So, it's connected in this way actually. For a polymer, this is quite general. For a polymer, the number, so let's say the partition function of a polymer typically goes like mu to the n by some n to the some exponent gamma minus 1. Okay, so this is total number of walk for some polymer model. This is quite general. That are composed by n monomers. Okay, so that's how they grow. So there is an exponential part and a power law part. Okay, so. This in general is quite understood if you do it on a lattice. So suppose we go a bit step back. So suppose that we are analyzing random walks. So super simple model on a cubic lattice. So for a random walk on a cubic lattice, a random walk in d dimension. So this function goes like 2d to the n, okay? Or if there's no term here, or if you want gamma is equal to zero, Okay. And why this is so? Because anytime I'm here, I have 2D possible direction where I can go. So that's the actually this is exact. It's not even an approximation. This is for the random walk. Hmm? So as you can see, this formula works well for a random walk. For a self-avoiding walk, always on the dimension, this has this kind of form. Okay, and this mu here, it's a constant which depends on the lattice. It's not universal, it depends on the lattice you are using to model the system. So if you are on a cubic lattice, it's different that you are on a honeycomb. It depends, and it's still exponential, but it depends on the kind of lattice you are using. While this is actually the interesting dependence, because this exponent does not depend on the lattice you are using. It's a universal. So you can use the more convenient lattice if you want, in order, it depends on your code. So that's it, seen quite well for a self-avoiding walk. And now, this exponent here, actually, gamma, is related to theta, because theta is equal to gamma minus 1 divided by nu. So this exponent, theta, is actually connected to the entropy of your polymer, which is, if you want, is a bit obvious, because that's related to the contacts you can form in your chains. And if you want, the contacts is what, it's the only thing that distinguish a self-avoiding polymer from a random walk, because contacts are forbidden point contact. You cannot overlap two monomers by construction in a self-avoiding polymer. So it's quite natural that theta is related to the entropy of your walk. Okay. Gamma, as far as I know, so a generic expression from gamma does not exist, but I can give you the value, for instance, in 3D. Well, here it looks like it's almost exact. So, for instance, in 3D, just to show you that this thing is not negligible. gamma, of course, for self-avoiding walk in 3D, it's equal to, well, here the value is 1.160. Okay, it's approximated like 7 over 6. So it's larger than 1, of course. Which means that my exponent theta, it's 1 over 6 divided by, and I have to use nu in 3D, which I can use, and I can use the Flory approximation, no? It's 3 over 5. And so this is equal to 5 over 18, which is about, it's 0.275. So as you can see, it's not negligible at all. In fact, if you put, your simulation for self-avoiding polymer, and you plot this data, you will see, and you plot this, you will see that your probability distribution function will go to zero this way. For R going to zero, sorry, will go this way. And then it increases. Okay. So it's an important effect. It cannot really be neglected. Okay, yes.
What kind of argument do you think that the relation between the constants?
This one. I think, but to be honest, now I don't remember. I don't think it's entirely. Probably, yeah, I think you should, yeah, let me think. I think you should start from here.
Every lower implying a critical exponent.
Probably, yeah. To be honest, I've not reviewed how to derive this, but it's... Let me see, maybe it's here.
I think that the same as the one you get when you're doing.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, probably. Okay, so this, as I said, you derive it from, let's say, it's because self-forwarding polymers are overstretched with respect to standard Gaussian polymer. So this exponent theta is basically related to the, it's when you go to small distances. And I think if you go to small distances, you can, so you can relate, so you can write the, I think you relate the, you rate the number of conformation that have small distances through these, and then I think this is the path, and that's pathway, and then you get the relation between these two kind of responses. So you can see they are not independent, but theta and nu are independent. So I mean, they are two. So once you have the two, you can derive gamma, or if you have gamma, you can find theta. But you have these two exponents are completely independent. So they are both necessary. And in particular, the theta exponent, that's why it's the Flory theory, it's where the Flory theory is profoundly wrong. It's wrong that it doesn't have a prediction for the exponent theta. Or if you want the exponent theta, it's zero by construction for the Flory theory. And that's its more severe defect. But okay, in spite of that, it works, apart from that, it works quite well. And I want just to conclude with this. Maybe then we do just a small break with the following. So suppose, because this is something that we have said yesterday. So suppose that I have. You remember yesterday we had so for a Gaussian chain. So let me ideal polymer. So you remember that I derived the looping probability, the fact that we have two ends, and I want to know what is the probability that for two points on the chain, I mean at the ends of the chain, what is the probability that this thing close? And I told you that I don't remember which notation I've used yesterday, but the closing probability p that r equal zero for a Gaussian chain that goes like one over n b times d over two. This is in d dimension, right? So in the as someone of you observed yesterday, this is just related to the return probability for a random walk. That's the dependence for a random walk. Yes. But how that changes for a self-avoiding walk? So as a polymer. So if you then that's quite easy to derive now because we have everything. You just use this function, and then you have that p for r. Well, here we cannot use really zero because we know that for r equal to zero, that just basically the probability is zero by construction because two monomers cannot overlap. But you can always say that I took a microscopic distance, let's say the size of roughly the size of my monomers in order to derive my closure probability, and that will go like NB, it will be like nu d plus theta, Okay, if I use, and you can see why, because nu theta comes from here, right? While the terms d come simply from the normalization of my function. And if you want, this is a perfect general. You can see immediately that this is a generalization of this, because if I use here theta equals zero and nu equal 1/2, which is the prediction of for a Gaussian polymer, I just recover this this formula. So this is quite good that you take into your mind, because this property, I mean the contact, probably something that people can actually measure now in chromosomes. So now we will, I mean, when I will tell you a bit more on chromosome, we will actually compare these two functions to real biological data, and we will derive some conclusion about it. If they are adequate, no, not adequate, I mean, we will see. Actually, if you put numbers here, you, for instance, in d equal 3, so we can just compare. So what you get here, can we? So suppose that I have d equal 3. So that goes like 1 over nb, 1 over 5, sorry, 1, yeah, 3 over 2, which is 1.5. While if you put d equal 3 here, let's put numbers. So I have nb. So I have for nu is 3 over 5. D is equal 3. Again, and theta, I said it's, forgot, is 5 over 18, oh, horrible, 5 over 18, so now I have to beat, so it's 1 and b, so it's 3 over 5, 3 per 8, 4 per 2, 3 per 54 plus 5 divided by 18. So I simplify this. So this is 1 over nb. So it's 59 divided by 30. So it's about 1. So that's about. So it's 59, it's not 60, but it's very close. So it's 1 over nb to the square, roughly. I mean, it's a bit less. And so as you can see, and as you can expect, this law here is much steeper, not much, it's steeper than this one, which is just nb 1.5. So this property will be very useful when we analyze, I mean, we'll discuss experiments on chromosome, because we will compare to those laws, because it's exactly what people can measure in chromosome, this close, let's say, contact probability. And so that's very useful to compare to this kind of theoretical prediction, okay? What time is it now? You want to do a break? Yeah. Half past three. Okay, we'll make 5 minutes break. So I take some water too. Theta, yes. Yes. So, in fact, maybe I can, sorry. Yes.
Four, yeah. Infinity, yeah. Yes, because p is smaller than four, that's positive. The exponent is positive. D minus, yeah. Is it clear?
Yes. Question about mu. When is mu that you define in the for the partition function?
Ah, it's just a constant. Okay. It depends on the, actually it's not universal, it depends on the lattice you have.
So when we write the packaging
solution, all the pairs. So no, that describes.
We can talk later or tomorrow. I mean, I'm here, so. Yeah, I think it's useful if I tell you this thing that I have in mind, but I need a bit of more time, so I will be more specific tomorrow, because otherwise I have to rush a bit. So this is something actually I have not told you when we mentioned. So we go a bit a step back to the, let's say, to the ideal polymers, because this is also if somehow it's useful. So we know that. So actually, the kind of the system that I've mentioned so far, it's the kind of all the theory that I've done so far is for, let's say, I call it free polymers. Free polymers, I mean polymers who are not in confinement. So either if it is a Gaussian chain or a self-avoiding walk, and in general, even a polymer in solution, these properties are for a polymer in bulk. Even when I did the picture, no, when I took polymers which I start to compress, the system is always meant to be. So I just repeat the drawing a bit larger. Even in this case, so for a melt, I mean, the typical size. So this is the container. But the typical size of my polymer chain, I said that R goes like B and 1/2 for a polymer, for a linear chain in a melt. So, but still, this quantity is much smaller than, if I call it L box, than the typical size of, let's say, of my container. So if you want, a confinement effect can be neglected. So it's a real, it's like in a bulk. So why I said that? I said that because actually this condition is not obvious that is relevant. For instance, for chromosome, because we know that we have a nucleus, okay, and we have our polymers here, our chromosome, which are more or less swollen. But now this is in real, we need to wonder if the confinement is important, namely, if the equilibrium size of the chain is much smaller, comparable, or if the size of the chain when it's free is much smaller, comparable, or much larger than the nucleus, than the size of the nucleus. So just to give you an example of of the biological systems we are going to discuss, and that's very important, of course, because in the first case, if the typical size of my, let's say, of my chromosome free when it's free is not is much smaller than the size of the nucleus, then this is like a real solution, if you want. So the nucleus does not impact, or at least does not impact too much on the sides of the polymer. If it's comparable, it starts to have some impact. And if the free size, the size of the chromosome, let's say when it's free, without confinement, is much larger than the size of the nucleus, then I have to expect that the confinement effects are important. Okay. So we are going to discuss a little bit what it happens to polymers. So I go back again to to generic features of polymer when they are in confinement. Okay?
Is it different from the melt?
Well, the melt, yeah, it's a good question, thanks. But of course, the situation is not completely dissimilar. Okay, I will. Sorry, who asked that? Because I was. Ah, yeah. So I will be more specific to tomorrow because today I don't have the time. But the situation is the following. So in a melt, rigorously, I have, as I said, I have still many chains. And as I said, so you expect, because of the Flory theorem, that the let's say the size of my chain at equilibrium has to grow, as I said, as a Gaussian polymer. But then, so this, I mean, if you calculate, if you put here the typical size of a monomer times the number of my monomers, then I get a number, and then I have to compare to the size of the container. If this can be much smaller than the size of container, I have many chains, right? So then in this case, the confinement is practically negligible. Maybe I have some confinement effects at the border of my container, but in the end, inside, that doesn't matter, no? Any chain does not feel the presence of the confinement, right? While, I mean, this is not always the case. So, yeah? But confined, so they are both confined. But in confinement, I mean that the, let's say, the size of the polymer when it's free, let's say, so in free space, it's much larger, of the size of the box. And in that case, the things change a lot, actually. And as I said, I mean, tomorrow will be more specific, but one thing that you can immediately see, so there are some equations that are exact, and tomorrow I will tell you more about that. But let's take the most simple system, which is, the Gaussian chain, right? Because we know everything, and it's there are no extruded volume effect, and it's simple. Sorry. So for a Gaussian chain, we know what is R is to go like B n to the 1/2, okay. And then suppose I confine this thing to a sphere of some diameter. So I have, and I have my chain. Then this thing has to be smaller, or if you want, in order to get to stay unperturbed from the condition to be free, has to be smaller or larger of the diameter of the sphere. So then it's a bit of a matter of definition, because I'm neglecting prefactors. But if I call this diameter d, then this thing has to be, in order to be to remain unperturbed, has to be smaller, let's say, of the diameter of the sphere. Which means that polymers remain unperturbed if n is smaller or comparable to d to the b squared, right? So this is the condition of the polymer. So there is let's say a crossover length for the polymers. And for this length, if I took a polymer which is much smaller than this length, so I can call it NC just to make like the crossover. If polymers are smaller than, are shorter than this length, then they stay in, I mean, the container does not play any particular role. But if they are larger, of course, it's a serious ingredient. It's a serious actor of the game, right? And that's very simple if you want to describe. I mean, at least for a Gaussian chain, how things have to go. Well, one can be more rigorous, but it's, in the end, it's. What you should expect is very simple. So if you have, so actually it's very useful if you, so you have the, your, okay, let's do it, let's do it here. So we have our sphere. I just take a sphere because it's simple, but of course, I mean, you can take a cube. I mean, that doesn't change too much. So I have my chain here. And then goes like this. And so the physical, I mean, the way you can describe the system is the following. So then now it's important. So you take any... If you take pairs of loci, or sorry, loci, pairs of monomers, sorry, on the chain, then you should expect the following. If you calculate the spatial distance between them, and I call it this thing n. No, this is the sorry. This is a single polymer folded, it's a Gaussian polymer, so it's an ideal polymer folded inside the sphere. So there are no extruded volume effects, so I can put any, any length can stay there, because there are no, so it's a bit an unrealistic situation. But okay, for time being, let's do this, because it's that can be done, I'll show you tomorrow, it can be done exactly. I mean, it can be done, everything can be done exactly. But for time being, just let me... Let me just stay a bit qualitative. So I took two pairs of monomers on my chain, and then I calculate the distance between these two monomers, the average distance, let's say, between these two monomers as a function of n. And of course, you can see what would be the result. I mean, that has to be like n. B n to the 1/2, okay? When, then I can use this result, when n is smaller or equal to d over b square, right? And then, of course, it's simple. What can do this polymer? Can only have a distance which is the order, okay, so of the diameter of my container, right? It has to be like this. Sorry? Yeah, it has to be of this order. Actually, you can derive a precise relation, but it's the same order. It's the maximum length it can get, no? Because it has to explore, and on average, has to stay on this order of magnitude. No, R is the average distance between the two pairs of monomers on the chain. And I'm asking how this quantity grows in terms of the linear distances on the polymer, right? So for a free polymer, this is always like this, because it's a Gaussian polymer. But here, is no longer the polymer is no longer free, because it's in a container. And then this thing, because of this relationship, has to be like a Gaussian relationship up to this contour length, and then has to be order of d for larger contour length, because simply the polymer is confined. So any, let's say, it's like having any two random monomers, any two random points, if you want, inside the sphere, and then the average distance between them has to be of the order of diameter. That's it. But so then, this is quite important, because you can see that there is a crossover length that tells you when confinement effect becomes relevant. Okay? And tomorrow, I need to be, I want to be a bit more specific on this. You can derive the, and actually, only for ideal polymers, you can derive an exact formalism that I think is quite useful. We'll tell you about tomorrow. And we will also discuss a little bit about confined polymer, because even by using extruding the volume effects, because they are quite useful. And also, people can do experiments on that, apart from the fact that, of course, they are related to chromosome or not. It's not only, I mean, they have more general application than just chromosome. But we can do it tomorrow, because I need a bit more time. So if you have questions, maybe I can answer you. Yeah.
This is a decorrelation assumption, right? That
yes.
The overall thing doesn't matter, the smaller things.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Is it because of the Gaussian nature?
It's because of the Gaussian nature, yes. So because when you go here, right, basically it's like having, it's reflecting, no? It's like having a mirror. And then, because this direction is decorrelated. Actually, things become more complicated. I didn't talk about it, and yeah, I see if I have the time, but things become more complicated if you, so this is, so Gaussian polymer, or I mean, this or also free Gentile chain, whatever, they are example of flexible polymers, right? But suppose I have what is called a worm-like chain, which is a semi-flexible polymer. Then I have yet another length scale, which is the persistence length or the cool length, whatever. And then this also play a role, because basically a semi-flexible polymer is characterized by a length scale. It's like a rigid rod, it's like a spaghetti. So below some scale, my polymer is very stiff. Above some scale becomes to be, because of thermal fluctuation, becomes more and more flexible. And of course, you can imagine if you have this such kind of polymer, my confinement, I mean, D, is comparable or smaller than this persistence length, and then the conformation of the object is completely different. It cannot, is no longer described by this. But of course, I mean, it becomes more complicated. Since it's, I don't know if I have the time to do that. I will probably not. And since it's not really relevant for the chromosome, for the biological part that I have to tell you in the last lectures. And we will not talk about that. But it's relevant if you have, for instance, DNA in very strong confinement. So that will be important. But I mean, will not be important from what I'm going to tell you in the rest. So we'll not talk about that probably. Yes. No, it's much smaller. Yeah. For what? For DNA. LP DNA, it's equal to 150 base pair, which means it's about 50 nanometer. Yes, 50 nanometer? No, sorry, the opposite. Is No, it's right. It's 50 nanometer, which is 150 base pair. You know, it's correct. Yes. Am I telling you some bullshit? No, it's correct. It's correct. This is for double-stranded DNA in, let's say, in normal conditions, in normal salt. The persistence, because the persistence length can change considerably according to the salt conditions, because DNA is a charge. But the experiments where people have measured this were in, let's say, in physiological cell conditions with, I think they used magnesium ions, Mg2+, and that should be more or less, I want to say something not correct, but it's, in physiological condition, and in this condition they found these values for, this is the accepted value for DNA. And that's, of course, it's not small. It's, you can see it's 150 base pair. That means you really, I mean, it depends by what are you doing. But since you can prepare, actually, for instance, the people can study DNA on a slab or in channels or nanopores, whatever. And in that case, and they are very nanopores, so they are very small. They are much smaller than these, like the linear size. They are much smaller than these. So then, this physics does not apply there. But for chromosomes, this is not relevant because, even for bacteria, bacteria have the DNA of bacteria is 1 megabase pair. Which is a disease has to be, it's basically DNA, so which means that it's about 1,000, not even more, no? Is 5,000 larger than this, and so it's doesn't matter. I mean, the confinement is not tight. So, while it matters, for instance, for viruses. So DNA, viruses with DNA, no, because there are also viruses with RNA. But viruses for RNA, with the DNA, the viral capsid is comparable or smaller than the 50 nanometer. So the DNA is basically make some kind of order inside of the viral capsid. So then for viruses, you have to take into account confinement and the semi-flexibility is not simple, but we are not going to talk about bio, so, which is a totally fascinating subject. It's not because I don't like it. It's a different physics. Okay? For chromosome, doesn't matter. I mean, it's not really relevant. I mean, so we can use this physics. Okay, so let's continue tomorrow. If you have a further question, you can just ask.